as the madam was telling about the indigenous safe kit that we have made, the basic idea when we were asked to explore or the thing from where to procure the kit and everything, so the main factor that came into making our own indigenous kit was basically the cost. Because anywhere it costed about 500-600 rupees to procure it from outside. And this kit, I'm told that cost less than rupees 300. So even if we add some few modifications also, still then I feel that this will be a very low cost or cost effective kit that would be used indigenously in our department. And before we demonstrate this kit and its contents to you one by one, since many residents and interns are sitting over here, I just wanted to make a brief note about how to use this kit and what are the precautions when you use this kit. Basically, when we deal with the examination of a survivor of sexual assault, the medico-legal part of examination mainly deals with noting down or filling up the pro forma that you are all aware of, filling up the pro forma that is given up by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And then, of course, preserving the evidence towards it. So the kit is basically to aid in that, to aid in collection and preservation of all the evidences that you can find during your examination on the body of the survivor. So there are... this protocol, I think you all are aware of. Whenever a survivor of sexual offence comes for examination, these are the steps that one has to follow. First of all, as soon as she comes, the first and foremost thing is to take the consent and give the first statement. Before going into the details of the history and what happened and what not happened, just having the brief idea of what the case is, the first thing you do is take the consent, give the first aid, and then go about taking the detailed history. Now again, here the history taking becomes a difficult task, considering how or which type of survivor it is. If it is a child, the history taking becomes a totally assumes a totally different area of approach. And if it is an adult, it becomes much easier, I would say, but still very requires a lot of empathy and patience. And then the examination part. And during the examination part, you also assess the age of the person. So age, if it is documented, well and good. If it is not, then we always send her for age estimation. And then after or along with the examination, we are also required for evidence collection. Now, evidence collection is again for treatment part as well as the medico-legal part. So, medico-legal evidence collection is where the safe kit is going to aid you. Okay? And in all this safe kit, everything regarding the sampling or the sealing or separate, whatever you are collecting as sample or medico-legal evidence, it has to be collected, kept in a separate envelopes or the vials or the jars, whatever the samples you are collecting, according to that, properly sealed, labeled, and then handed over to the police. Now, the basic things to understand is that, first of all, you should be knowing what you should collect, in which case what should be collected. So that is the first and foremost thing that should be very clear. And always keep in mind, the history is the main thing which guides us about what to collect. Okay, if a survivor comes with the history of, say, anal intercourse, we are not going to collect a vaginal swab or a vaginal smear. Okay, so history is the main thing which will actually guide us to what to collect and what to look for. So first of all, always rely on the history in which direction. Suppose a survivor comes and gives the history of oral intercourse. Why should we go for a collection of samples from the genitalia? Okay. So always concentrate on the history, decide what was to be collected and accordingly collect the samples. It is not a protocol to be followed as such in each and every case. Each and every case is different and accordingly you have to preserve the samples. Secondly, history also tells you about the time of incidence. If the time is not, if there a lot of time has been, or there is a lot of time difference between the examination and the incidence, again there is not many chance that most of the evidences have been lost. So in such cases, when we say that after 4 days there is no need to prepare a vaginal smear or test for presence of spermatozoa, again it is valid. Only thing is your time of examination, your start of examination, or the date of examination and the date of incidence should be clearly mentioned in your pro forma or the examination part. So depending on the history, what should be collected, how it should be collected, that should be decided upon. Secondly, once we have collected the evidence, then we should be clear for what we are sending. Suppose I am collecting a vaginal smear, what am I expecting the FSL person to do with it? So it is not that you just collect the vaginal swab and give it to the police ki ab iski jaanch karwao. You should be very clear in your mind what the police or what the police should do with it. Or if it, he is going to send it to FSL, what do you expect the FSL person to do with it? So in your labeling, it should be very clearly written that this is a vaginal smear for detection of spermatozoa, or it is a vaginal smear for detection of semen, or it's a vaginal swab for detection of semen, or it is a blood of the victim or stain on the clothing for detection of the semen, or blood of the victim, or blood found on the body for DNA examination. So whatever thing you are collecting it for, that should be clearly written on the labeling, so that the when the evidences are collected, it should go to a proper place for analysis. Then only it's useful, its objective is achieved. Otherwise, you simply collect the samples, nobody knows what to do with it, and all your efforts are going to pain. So that is very important. You should be very clear about why you are collecting it, to whom it is to be sent, for what. That should be very clear in the labeling that is there. So labeling should include the name, age and sex of the person, the MLC number under which we are examining, the police station from which the case is being referred to, or you are, if it has not come directly to you, the police station where you are referring it to. Okay. Then also the what is preserved and for what it is being preserved. Okay, like vaginal swab to be tested for presence of semen. Okay, so that thing, whole thing should be very clearly written on the label, and after that you should sign, the preserving doctor should actually sign the label and then send it. Then whenever you are sending any seal for examination, and these are the list you might be required to collect when you examine a victim of sexual assault, it might include clothing. And now remember, all these are not to be collected in each and every case. Again, as I told you, it will depend on the history. From this list, what all can be collected, or what all is available, or apart from this also, if anything else comes to us, or if any foreign body is present or something else is there, that could also be collected depending upon the case. So this is just a general list. What is usually collected, but it is not necessary that in each and every case that all the things should be collected. So there could be clothing, there could be vaginal swab and smear, vulval swab, anal swab, oral swab. Again, all the three things may be present in one case, needed in one case, or it may be only one thing. So from any body surface, according to history, suppose there is a stain, blood stain of the accused on the victim's body, or the seminal stain somewhere else, so that can also be taken. Or there is bite mark, you would like to take the salivary stains from that area. Scalp hair is there, pubic hair, blood samples, nail scrapings or clippings, urine sample or any other foreign body which is found. So when these samples are collected, it is very important from medical legal perspective that all these samples should be properly sealed, because FSL will not accept any unsealed samples from you or from the police for that matter. Because unless these samples are sealed, and the person who is opening that sample, he should be the next in line who should be analyzing it. That is known as the chain of custody. Chain of custody is that you have, suppose, collected the sample, you label it, seal it, and then send it to the next person in line, and the next person should receive it in the sealed condition. Only then it will be medico-legally valid. Okay, so that is what is called as chain of evidence or chain of custody. So chain of custody should be very clearly maintained. Okay. So chain, har sample ko hum ya to tape se chipka ke ya lock se chipka ke ya usme gauze lapet ke kapda hai, then we usually seal it, cover it with a gauze or make a portly with a gauze and put the lock seal so that it is sealed in some way. Okay. So it is very important, whatever sample you are sending it through the police to the FSL for further examination, that should be properly sealed and properly labeled. So these are the two very basic precautions that you should be doing while you are collecting the medical legal evidences. So this is how, these are the basic things which should be present in the emergency department and the alarm and the scene of AIIMS Bhopal, so that the person who receives the sample also knows that this sample has come from AIIMS Bhopal. So this sealing is very important, because otherwise it is not a valid sample. And this is the labeling. Labeling should is also very important, because it involves all the information you want to send it. Because it does not, when the sealed samples are there, they are not mixed up, the cases are not mixed up. And though the FSL requires that one copy of one report that you have prepared for the examination of the survivor, that goes along with the samples that are taken to the FSL, still each and every sample should be labeled. Okay? So there you write down the MLC number, the age and sex of the survivor, date where it was collected, the police station from which the case has been referred or you have referred the case to, or what item has been preserved, and for what. Now this is very important. Only item preserved, you should not write vaginal swab. Vaginal swab for semen testing or vaginal swab for DNA, whatever you want to do. So for what you are preserving, and name and sign of the medical officer who is preserving. So the label should include all the details that is there. So this is what I wanted to tell you before you go with the intricacies and the ingredients of the safe kit that has been designed. First of all, have very clear things in your mind what we have